evening, friends. Just waiting for Mr. Saeed Naqvi, but I think by the time our introduction is over, he'll be here. So he's, is the light on top? Am I audible in the back?
Yes.
Welcome all of you to LILA PRISM 2015. We're delighted to see all of you, and we're very happy that Mark is here. Before we start this series of lectures, I think some of you are like, you've been attending our lectures and programs. Some of you know what this is about, but maybe some of you are new, so I'll just tell you a little bit about what this is, what's the context of this series. LILA has just celebrated its third birthday on August 2nd, so August is an important time for us because it's 3 years back in August that we started this whole enterprise. And this is the third edition of LILA PRISM lectures. And LILA works with the motto, I have a script because I just want to stick to the time, otherwise it will just go on and on. LILA works with the motto, happiness sustains life, because it puzzles us that the limitless amount of information and knowledge that we handle daily is still not making us really happy. Why is our media so full of bleak news? Why are our development models not inclusive? Obviously, there's a problem in our managing our knowledge, the way we govern ourselves. The conflicts and othering that we see around us tell us that it is important to bring people from different walks of life while we think about this issue and act upon it. This coming together, we hope, would also give each of us the necessary distance from ourselves, like what we have in the act of play. LILA is named after play, and we are completely immersed when we are in play, and yet we are detached. So this LILA for us is the basis of appreciating life. So LILA is also the luminous idea of life appreciation. The interdisciplinary PRISM series. PRISM is for us the translucent key for transformation that stands for, the letters stand for performativity, relevance, innovation, sustainability, and multiplicity. And we launched this in 2013 with the theme Development in India. And almost all of our 15 speakers in 2013 said our development models in their own fields, they are not inclusive, there is discontinuity, at times fragmentedness. So we wanted to think about this. You know, this is the problem that we have identified. What do we do about it? So last year, we had a series of lectures, most of them practitioners from various areas. We call it Cultures as Continuum. And the talks ranged from food, cotton, health, traditional arts, tribal cultures, etc. So we gained a lot of insight from these two years and the reflections. So this year's series is a natural extension of this quest to see what makes governance transformative for the individual, for the community, for the country, and for the world at large. So this series on transformative governance gathers insights from fields ranging from media to urban governance, the arts to trade, architecture to science, law to gender, and features some of the most eminent minds in the country as speakers and chair. LILA is indeed a people's movement. We're just a handful of volunteers that we are able to bring this and more to you. We have a lot of other programs also, year after year, is evidence to the fact that happiness is where sharing is. Our speakers and chairs, the institutions that collaborate with us, and many of our well-wishers who lend their support in many different ways, and all of you, we see that almost always our halls are crowded, say this year. We're just starting.
You should have given a little latitude for traffic. Sorry for that.
No. At this point, I would also like to mention that this is also a very poignant moment for us. This is kind of personal for Leela. Tomorrow it will be 1 year since our trustee, Jaswant Singh, fell into a coma. August 7th, 2014, he slipped and fell at his home and he was rushed to the Army hospital. We had just begun last year's PRISM lectures when he fell. As we begin this new series on governance, a topic so close to Jaswant's heart, we wish him speedy recovery and hope he soon wakes up and returns to the play. He has been with us. He worked with us only for 5 months, but those 5 months were really remarkable and memorable. We dedicate our thoughts on governance in the series to Jaswant. This brings me to today's topic. A year back, every day I would drive past the gates of the RLR hospital to check on Jaswant, and I would see the media vehicles lined up outside the hospital, waiting for something to happen. Every time I saw it, my heart sank. And this was there for 2 weeks, and in 2 weeks he was forgotten. And now nobody is interested when he lies there alone, unconscious. So every time these kind of things happen, it makes us think, don't we have a better way of gathering news? Should not there be a more subtle, compassionate way to be in this space? Ultimately, what is the role that media must play in our society? At LILA, we have come to see that the most important function of the media is to keep the thread of memory alive. As Milan Kundera said, the struggle of man against power is a struggle of memory against forgetting. And the media must be our strongest ally in this struggle against forgetting. And then we will have it playing a transformative role in the society. Today, we are honored to welcome Sir Mark Tully and Saeed Naqvi to LILA PRISM 2015, two people who have really lived their true journalist lives. Mark joined the BBC in 1964 and moved back to India in 1965 to work as the India correspondent. He covered nearly every happening in India in the next 30 years, from Indo-Pakistan conflicts, Bhopal gas tragedy, Operation Blue Star, the subsequent assassination of Indira Gandhi, anti-Sikh riots, assassination of Rajiv Gandhi, the devolution of Babri Masjid, all this. He was barred from entering India during the emergency. And since 1994, he's been here working, freelancing, writing. He was knighted in 2002 and received the Padma Bhushan in 2005. His books include No Full Stops in India, India's Unending Journey, Non-Stop India, and the like. Mark Tully is currently working on a series of short stories about rural India. Personally, this is a very moving moment for me. I read him first when I was a student in college, and I still remember reading No Full Stops in India. And so it's actually very moving for me to actually stand by the side of this man whom I read as a minor, actually. Saeed Naqvi has been a major reporter and foreign correspondent for 4 decades He's traveled the length and breadth of India and visited over 100 countries in pursuit of stories. He's done landmark TV interviews with people ranging from Fidel Castro to Nelson Mandela to Saddam Hussein to Benjamin Netanyahu. While his writings and lecture tours have been path-breaking efforts, his equally important contributions have been in the field of culture. His three-part DVD on the history of Hindustani music and 35 short films on India's composite culture are examples. He's also an expert on Urdu poetry and has given many talks in this area. He's done work in this area. Mark Tully and Saeed Naqvi, we are honored and delighted that you're here. Over to you, Saeed. Sir Mark is all yours.
Thank you very much. I am indeed flattered that PRISM lecture series has in its, I think, the opening lecture with Mark Tully has invited me to be in the chair. It's particularly the fact that I'm Mark and I are sharing the same podium, the same platform. Leaves me with a set of memories you talked about. And I think journalism as you said is memory recollected or memory stored and of course coverage of instant history and so on and so forth. Today's journalism and yesterday's journalism. It's very ironical that when I reflect my life as a journalist and my grandchildren come to me and they're talking about their careers and they think of journalism, I discourage them. And I say, no, this is the wrong profession today. And yet, ironically, if you ask me, given another life, what would you do? I would say I would be doing exactly what I did the last 45 years as a journalist. So there is this paradox which needs to be explained a little bit. A paradox, and I'm sure you are, Mark will dilate on aspects of this. Elections were on. Mark Tully and I were in Mahmudabad covering the elections. The pundits of today generally do not go out into the field, but in those days we never wrote a line without having been there. So we were in Mahmudabad, and there we run into a man sleeping on a cot under a mango tree, and we walked up to him, and we asked him to, if we could talk to him. He said, he got up, and he said, yes. I said, we're just trying to size up who are this particular area, there's candidate X and Y and Z. Who are you people? What is the general mood here? He looked at us very shrewdly and he said, listen, unless I heard it on the BBC, I will not tell you a thing. In those days, that was the credibility of the BBC radio. Let me emphasize, BBC radio had that kind of credibility. Nothing in Indian journalism has ever touched it. You went to the remotest areas, and through the Hindi programs and the language programs, BBC had reached them. And it had been covered adequately. This was then. I was posted about the same time that Mark was in India, was posted to India. I was posted by the Statesman to Rajasthan. And I became plenipotentiary rights representative, they used to call. They didn't have correspondent, they said special representative in Jaipur. There was a big famine. I was young and green. I learned to expose things in the civic domain here and in Delhi. And I thought I would expose this famine. So I got into my little Hillman I had in those days, and I drove around Rajasthan. And I went to the Rajasthan canal area. And I found a terrible state of affairs as far as I came back to Delhi, came back to Jaipur, and I found all my contemporary newspapers, Times of India, Hindustan Times, Indian Express, everybody had page one banner headlines: Rajasthan canal gushes with water, desert blooms. And I said, my God, I've just been there. This is a lie. I saw it. I drove straight into the office of Rajendra Shankar Bhatt, very effective director of public relations. I said, Bhatji, what have you done? He says, kya? I said, I have been to these places. There's terrible famine. There is no water in the canal. And front page pictures. He says, Naqvi sahab, jo chhap gaya, wahi satya hai. He said, that which has been published is the truth. I went back, and with an echo in my mind of the bells, and I sat down and hammered out my first story. And I wrote, I exactly remember that story because it had consequences. The exclusive Goebbels formula that an untruth, if widely publicized, ultimately becomes the truth, comma, appears to have been applied to the Rajasthan Canal project with obvious success. And then I go on to describe A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. Next. The Statesman came, I was with the Statesman, of course, came, and it was second lead. Now that's a very big score for a young, aspiring journalist. But within the hour, I got a call from the editor. Can you please come back to Delhi? I said, I went to him back here. The editor. In those days, Pran Chopra was in transition, and the Charlton and Bolton, and Pran took over the talk. He said, will you describe somebody as Goebbels? You're calling somebody Hitler. You know, when he sent you to a state capital, one thing you must remember is that your judgment has to be faultless. You simply cannot be swept off your feet and use hyperbole. Use this kind of language, nothing, no more than that. I was called, corrected, and sent back home. Now, that was because the opening sentence, in those days, you have to be a little thing like Delhi News in Brief. You have to be careful what went in, and the editors would read it. And they say it appeared in the Hindustan Times and not here. Today the editors don't read the newspapers. They don't. There were two schools that come back and with red and blue pencils, and that newspaper was distributed. So that was the Mark, this is actually Mark's evening. And he, when I talk of the BBC radio, not only he exemplified BBC radio, I mean, he really created it. The standard in our days, and I think Mark will bear me out, was the independent newspaper. The independent newspaper was independent in the real sense of the term. In other words, in a democracy, people brought in a government, whether it was a Vajiran Dal government, or a Congress government, or a left front government, or a communist government, or a BJP government, it did not matter. People have brought this government into being. The role of the independent newspaper was to accord critical support to the establishment. In other words, your job is, people have brought in this lot, now you on an issue by issue basis, critical. But your job is not to bring them down, your job is not to unsettle them, your job is to, this is people's verdict, I guess, to accord them support on a critical one, A, B, C, D, E, F, and very critical they were. Two, this lovely spell was broken by two things, and I expect, and I suspect Mark will dwell on those. This lovely spell was broken first in 1975 by Mrs. Gandhi's emergency. Emergency divided the elite, divided the media, between those who hated Indira Gandhi and those who hated Indira Gandhi. It became, and that division remained. And a classical example of that was when Indira Gandhi came back in 1980 and to power, the debate, and I spoke to Ramnath Gulka. I said, my old principle was, yes, when she had lost, you supported that government, I was part of that. But now that she's won, I think I'm appealing. I am not on talking terms with her. That's your personal thing. But as an independent newspaper, your job is to deal with her. Now, rushed two gentlemen. One was my good friend Arun Shuri, and the second was Ramesh Thapar. Two very different people, but they had a common cause in Indira Gandhi. They ran to Ramnath Goenka, and their plea was this: Ramnath ji, you and Arun are a one-man opposition to Indira. Please don't let down. In other words, in their mind, the newspaper's role had already become that of the opposition. We had shifted. So that was the first problem. The second is more global and more recent, and we are still paying the price for it. This is when the global media was born after the Soviet Union had collapsed, after, and instead of it being a victory of freedoms, it became a huge big victory of the market. And the market then began to dictate everything, and it dictated not only things here, and distorted the newspaper. That is why my advice to the children, listen, when we pull back, and we are recovering, we will recover. It will not last. It will not be like this. And the BBC lost the elan that it had up to the 90s, and Mark will bear me out on that. On that note, I think, Mark, it is your turn to either stand there or sit here. Why not? So, Sir Mark Tully.
I would like to distance myself slightly from what Saeed says. I was the front guy for the BBC, but we had people in all the different towns of India We had people back in London as well. So I was, in effect, the guy who benefited from all these other people working. And I do remember one occasion where I was saved from a massive blunder by one of my colleagues back in London, because when Narasimha Rao became Prime Minister, I remembered that he had not intended to stay in politics, because he told me so. And he said, I'm not going to fight this election. So I said in a dispatch that he is not even a member of parliament. And I immediately got a call back before the dispatch had been broadcast, thank God, from one of my colleagues in the Hindi service in London, who said, you got it wrong. He is a member of the Rajya Sabha. So we were a team, and I'm not going to say whether the BBC is a better or worse organization. Now, I can say one thing absolutely, though, that journalism and the BBC were more fun in those days. And I had a wonderful time, and I benefited far more than I deserved to benefit from all the time I spent. I'm honored to be asked to give this lecture, and I'm particularly glad that I should be doing it for the LILA Foundation, with which my old friend Jaswan Singh is associated. And I have to confess in front of you that I had not been to take part with him in his lonely vigil, which is something I'm now reminded of and I'm deeply ashamed of. I've been asked to speak to you about media and transformative government. Well, I'm going to say some things which may make a lot of you angry. But if you're asked to speak about something, there's no point in not putting what you see as the situation, what that lies in your heart, before your audience. As I see it, the first thing I need to do is to talk a little bit, explain a little bit about how I have understood media and transformative government. Let's take transformative government first. I believe the transformative government is that government which can transform the lives of people. And in this country, particularly the 20% poor and the 50% aspirant middle class. And I think that in particular, the way that lives need to be transformed among the less fortunate Indians is in the areas of health and of education. Because if they are to live full lives and happy lives, and if they are to take part as members of aspirational generation, they must have health and they must have education. And only a week or so ago, a young friend of ours who has chosen to do 2 years living in villages in Rajasthan came to tell us about what she had found there. And it was a terrible story, I'm afraid to say. In particular, she said that the schools were not worth going to because the teachers were either absent or gossiping with each other, that they ad-lib, put classes together, signs of enthusiasm or anything like that, and that the health centers were virtually non-functional. And she told us a particularly sad story that these are tribal villages and there are a lot of snakes in tribal villages, and a lot of people get snake bites. And because there is no anti-venom serum in these health centers, a lot of ladies in particular have their legs amputated. So this is the picture in a Rajasthan village. And I think this picture is reflected in the figures that worry us all. The figures which, for instance, of the United Nations Human Development Index, which places India at a lowly 135 among 186 countries. And that, as we all know, that for so many of us, India is a wonderful country to live in. And for so many of us, we have everything we want here. And yet, the overall total brings India so low there. There is the multidimensional poverty, which is reputed, said to be 55%. And there are said to be 48% of stunted children. Now, these stunted children are a particularly worrying crisis, because, as you all know, damage done through malnutrition at a young age cannot be repaired. So we have these figures, we have these stories, everyone tells stories like my friend Anitisha does. I've seen these sort of schools, I've seen these health centers many times, but it's much better that I tell you someone else rather than giving you the picture. So that's the transformative government, the government which can make those schools work, the government which can transform those schools, transform those health centers, transform all the other services which should be being provided to people in villages, slums, and everywhere else, of course, in India. And what about the media? Well, why do I ask that? Because you would say, which media? Because nowadays, we cannot talk about the media without talking about social media as well. And to me, the social media is somewhat like an electronic version of India's famous rumour mill. And we used to suffer heavily in the BBC from the rumour mill, because we did have the good fortune to have a high credibility rating, and so people, when they wanted to spread rumours, would say, "Mene hamne BBC persona." And we had so many occasions with people, we'd get incessant telephone calls from people saying, "Hamne suna ki BBC ne kaha ki Rashtrapati mar gaya," or something like that. And we had to say, ne, aisa ne, you know. So we suffered from this rumour mill. And of course, the internet is in a way an electronic rumour mill. And therefore, the social media lacks something which we in the more orthodox medias hope that we have, which is credibility. And so I hope very much that you will not mind if I don't talk about the social media. There is another good reason for this. People keep on telling me, for instance, that they SMS me. And I have to tell them I don't know how to un-SMS an SMS, if you see what I mean. So I'm not really au fait too much with it. But I do know that really the media which at the moment comes, and I think will always come, is the media which has credibility. So I want to talk about the media which has credibility, which is basically the newspapers and the broadcasting organizations, who of course do appear on the internet. And I also would like to say that I think what Marshall McLuhan said is the message, medium is the message. And by that I take him to mean that the medium affects how the message is perceived. And therefore, I think that it is important to realize when we consider media the different effects that the different media have. And I want to talk just one moment about the radio, which Saeed has talked about, because I think that this is a bit of a sidebar point, but it's very important for people to realize the power of radio. And the Prime Minister obviously does, because he does his man kibat on radio. Why is radio such a powerful medium? Well, there are two or three reasons. But one, of course, is convenience, that you can hear it in your car, you can hear it when you're shaving, you can hear it when you're drinking a tea in bed, you can hear it as you go to bed. Lots of people actually go to bed. In fact, I do a program on BBC called Something Understood, which goes out late on a Sunday night. And people are always telling me, "Your program sends me to sleep," which is not really very complimentary, but there you are. At least they listen at the beginning of it. But there are two other things, I think, why Modi, the Prime Minister, is right to have chosen radio. And they are, the first one is that in radio, it is a bit like your mother telling you a story. And if you remember as a child when your mother told you a story, what did you do? You imagined the pictures, you imagined, you had to add your own pictures to it. And in radio, we always say the pictures on radio are best. But the last and most important one, why radio is important, is because it is a very intimate medium. And all of you would realize that if you hear good radio, it sounds as though the person broadcasting is talking directly to you. And I always quote a lovely example which happened to me when I was speaking in England, and a lot of people came, and I said, I don't know why you've come, because I'm just a journalist. I might ask the same question today, incidentally. But anyhow, when I finished speaking, an old lady came up to me and said, I want you to know why I have come. And I said, yes, please do. She said, because I think you are my friend. Now, I think radio is the only medium in which you can get that sort of response. And therefore, radio, because you are working in your imagination, because you feel it's coming directly at you, to you, is a hugely powerful medium. And I bring this point up because one of the things I think we need to do in India is to break this ridiculous ban on radio as a news medium. And I think that if it's a message I want to use this platform, as I use every platform I ever speak from, and as I write about so often, to urge. Because radio can be and is a wonderful medium for transformation. And of course, it is being used by community radios and indeed by FM radios as well. But basically, I believe that it is underutilized because of the restrictions on it. Now, getting back to where we were, I better try and relate now the media with transformative government. I told you what I mean by the media, and I told you what I mean by transformative government. Well, I think the link is this, that politicians form governments and they react to the demands of people. The point I'm going to try and make is that the media can influence the demands that are put on, that are made of politicians. They can even create those demands. They can create a demand for the transformation which I have talked about. And that is the point I'm trying to make, really, that they can create a demand for the transformation of all those schools, all those health centers, all those electrification schemes which don't provide any electricity, all the rest of them. That demand can be created by the media. The best academic argument which demonstrates this, I think, is what Amartya Sen wrote about famine. And he compared India with China, which, as you know, during the time of Mao Zedong, endured dreadful famines. And he said, India never endured famine after democracy. And that was because of democracy and the role of the press. And you may be interested to know that back in the 19th century, in Orissa, a paper called Utpal Deepika was formed when there was a famine, and it played a tremendous role in informing what was happening in the famine and making it very difficult for the government to ignore the famine. And a similar paper in the same state was formed in the 20th century. So here we have an example endorsed by one of the world's leading economists of what the media can do to create a demand and to insist that that demand is met. And there is clearly a demand now in this country. The election last year clearly demonstrated that there are people who want change and people who want that change to lead to development. And basically the two go together. And the key words in Modi's whole campaign were the caste and Badlav. So there is a demand. But there is an enormous hurdle in the way of creating that demand. And the media is needed to create awareness of why that demand is so difficult to create. It is the media which needs to highlight what I might call the deficit in governance, particularly in the rural areas, so that voters of all sections of the country demand and tell the politicians that we demand the delivery of efficient and effective programs, and we demand that money which is allocated for those programs, for those packages, for those special status states, it not be wasted. And I needn't remind you of Rajiv Gandhi's famous statement about the way in which that money is wasted. In their joint book, An Uncertain Glory, India and Its Contradictions, Jean Drez and Amartya Sen point out that India does need to spend more money on health and on education. But clearly there is no point in spending more money if you're spending money which is going down the drain. In that book, they also speak right at the very start of persistent ineptitude and unaccountability in the way the Indian economy and society are organized. And the question which I want to ask of you is, can the media, and of us in the media, can we bring the demand that ineptitude, which is a wonderful word, it's a horrid word really, but it's a very telling word, that ineptitude stops? Can we try and put at the top of the agenda this problem of governance, of delivery? Because otherwise there will be no Badlav and there will be no Vikas, which goes right down to the bottom of society. Now you might argue, because of the corruption movement, that the media is already doing this. And certainly it is true that during the anti-corruption movement, the media played an enormous role. And as someone who was brought up in the BBC tradition where we value balance and impartiality, I was, to be honest, somewhat shocked by the way many of the reporters appeared to be cheerleaders for the movement. They went down to the Janta Manta or wherever else it was and seemed to be going there to be doing more cheerleading than the leaders of the movement themselves. Nevertheless, we have to say that the media did play a role, and in that role, they did highlight the problem of corruption. But there were two problems about this. They didn't take it any further. They didn't explain or go into the reasons for corruption, which are very largely bad governance, actually. Nor indeed did they much bother about the issue of corruption once the movement stopped. The issue of corruption for them just became the daily rather dreary search for yet another Gotala, again, without any real study of the causes or reasons for the Gotala. So what are these problems which the media should be exposing, should be helping to put on the top of the agenda? Well, one, of course, is the problems which my friend Nitish had told us about in the schools and the health centers and in so many other things. There's another very basic problem. A BPL is really a key, a card, to getting a large number of benefits from the government. Nitish has found that almost all the people with BPL cards in her villages weren't BPL at all. And when I was in a village once in Haryana, Uttar Pradesh, sorry, beyond Dadri, that side, and I wrote about this in a book, and I met a group of Dalits And I asked them how many of them had BPL cards. And they all said none. And then two lads at the back rather sheepishly held up their hands and said, well, I've got a BPL card. And there was an almost universal shout, ah, yes, Achai, you can upload a sarpanchka at me. In other words, the only people who had got BPLs amongst those Dalits were those who were in a position to be benefited by the ruling authority of the village of the sarpanch. So you've got the problem of BPL. You have another huge problem in resettlement. All this talk about the Land Acquisition Act, what no one is really talking about is what happens to people. You can say that people should be resettled with so much money, so much acreage of land, such big houses and all the rest of it. But fundamentally, you have to look at the truth of the matter, which is, as said to me by the World Bank about 20 years ago, India has never satisfactorily resettled a large group of people who have been ousted from their land. I can think of many stories which illustrate this, but there was one which only appeared quite as a sidebar story in the Hindustan Times. But it was a story in Chhattisgarh about a tribal who had been given some money. And there are a lot of crooked or unscrupulous motorcycle sellers descended on him. And because he was a simple man and everything, they managed to sell him about 20 motorcycles because he had no money left after that. Now this is just one of the problems. It's no good. Resettlement is not complete until you have re-established people's ways of earning a living, their livelihood, which you have taken away from them by taking up their land. And another story I remember happened to me in Singrauli when I went to see a resettlement where the tribals had been resettled twice, and both times for electricity power stations. And incidentally, if any of you want to see something like Blake's Dark Satanic Mills, I would advise you to go to Singrauli, where there is a lake which is ringed by power stations and an open cast coal mine. And you can imagine what a pretty place it is. But these tribals, I went with an official who said, you know, you're always saying there's no resettlement. Let me show you resettlement. So I went there, and we got talking to them. And then in the end, I said to them, what would you like? And they said, well, we have been resettled for electricity. There is an electricity power station there, and it would be nice if we could have some electricity. And the official, very rudely and officiously, just said, well, you can't afford electricity, can you? And this brings me to another thing, which is about governance at the rural level. And that is the callous and often offensive way in which local officials talk to the poorer people and their unhelpful, uncooperative attitude. And again, in Rajasthan, I remember asking a man who hadn't got a BPL card what the BDO, the Block Development Officer, would say if he went to see him. And he said, oh, he would just say to me, bargo, bargo. So this is another factor. And then there is the government's own lackadaisical attitude towards the problems which it should be solving, which would help the lot of rural India. There has been a great deal of attention on farmer suicides. And no one can say the media has not drawn attention to this fact. But again, we haven't been really going into the reasons for this and trying to highlight one. And I want to just give you one example, which is marketing. The inefficient marketing in this country leads to enormous losses to farmers. And there can be times when you go drive down a rural road and you find heaps of tomatoes, for instance, which have been dumped there because the market is not efficient enough to take it up. And the farmer says, if I take it 20 miles or so to the market, who's going to pay for me getting there? It's not worth it. And in 2003, Gilly, my partner, and I wrote about inept legislation in marketing. And we went to Darwa University, which is an agricultural university, and there we were told that India had done well on production in agriculture, but completely ignored post-production, which is marketing. And we discovered there, and when we went into the markets, that the system meant to help farmers, called agricultural products marketing, was hindering farmers. But even to this day, that was in 2003, that system has not been reformed or taken away. And now there is discussion of a national market. But Arvind Subramaniam, who is the finance minister's economic advisor, has said that, and who has been studying this marketing thing, has pointed out that farmers have benefited little from the agriculture product marketing committees. The law has tended to benefit commission agents. So that has been going on for all these years. It was highlighted in a very small way by us in 2003, but nothing has been done about it. And there are so many other things that the government could do that it sits on its hands about. One other final example of that, of course, is rural banking. When banks were nationalized, the idea was that, one of the ideas was that they would go into rural credit in a big way. But you get into almost any village in India and you'll find large numbers of people are still using mahajans or moneylenders. Why? Because the rural banking is so corrupt and so inefficient. Now, admittedly, we are hoping that action will take place on this through these electronic banking system which is starting. But why has it taken so long for people to be concerned about this? Now, all these are the sort of issues which we in the media should be drumming home all the time. We shouldn't just be content with saying another farmer's death or saying it's terrible, 500 farmers have committed suicide. Of course it's terrible. And we certainly shouldn't be using it for what I might call tear-jerking journalism, where you go and see a farmer, you poke a camera at some unfortunate member of the family who's father or husband has died and intrude on her or his grief and then think your job is done. We are not banging home these very obvious things which are wrong. I'm not saying that there are not exceptions. Of course there are. Peace Sign Up is an absolute shining example of an exception. But how many journalists are there? And there's one or two or three Peace Sign Up. Shikha Trivedi, and also on NDN, on New Delhi Television, Srinivas Jain, they do very good jobs. But how many really, actually, how often do these issues really come out? Why are the media not making us aware? What is the problem? What is it that makes us not take these things seriously? Well, I think we don't bother enough about them, and the upper classes don't bother enough about them, because actually they're not our problems. We can buy our way out of an educational difficulty. We can buy our health care. We don't need PPL cards. Very few of us, sadly, even travel by train these days. And we rarely come in contact with heartless, dishonest officials who make the lives of the poor so miserable. And it's because we buy ourselves out of these things that Harsh Munda recently published a wonderful book called Looking Away, Inequality, prejudice and indifference in New Delhi. It's a deeply disturbing book, and it was reading that book which made me think of my theme for this lecture. The media responsibility, or the role of the media, not the soul, we're not the only people, in involving us in looking away, and the role the media could play in encouraging us to look. At the very start of Harshmandir's book, he says, a paramount marker of the first decade of the 21st century India was the extraordinary indifference that people of privilege had for the intense and pervasive levels of human suffering all around. Now, isn't that something to be concerned about? Perhaps, or I can even use a stronger word and say, ashamed about. So don't we need to start looking, and don't the media need to start encouraging us to look? We journalists, we make many excuses for our failures. We talk about our owners and say that they're all businessmen and they're only interested in business. But we have surrendered our professional obligations because we have surrendered our duty as journalists to tell and insist the management, and the owners, and the administrators, and the managers that we are the people, because we are the professionals, who know what should go in the newspaper. And it is as if doctors, for instance, said, okay, we are going to allow managers and we are going to allow owners to tell us how to do our doctoring. And sadly, actually, I have to say, there is an element even of that in medicine these days, as you all know very well. But we, any more than doctors, have not stood up for our right and said, we are the ones, we are, if we are honest journalists, we know what our duty is, we should be allowed to do our duty because we are the professionals, and we don't. Of course, commerce and the influence on newspapers of owners who want to make business is to some extent offset in some countries by independent public service broadcasting like the BBC. And independent public service broadcasting can help in setting standards. There is no doubt about that. But it can't be the sole answer. And in India, of course, some people make the mistake of thinking that all India Radio and Doordarshan are what I would understand by public service broadcasting, whereas in fact they are government broadcasters. And I'll tell you a story to illustrate the difference between the two. When Indira Gandhi was assassinated, my very dear Satish Jacob was in charge of our office. I was up in Missouri, trying to keep up with Princess Anne, who was striding around the Himalayas looking at Tibetan schools. But Satish had the initiative to go to the hospital, speak to a doctor when Indira Gandhi was lying there. And he always tells the story when he said to the doctor, will she recover? He said to her, don't be a fool, she's riddled with bullets. So he came out and he broadcast to the world this story. And that must have been about 9:30, 10 in the morning. All India Radio was not allowed to broadcast that story until sometime in the afternoon, because it was government controlled. And it's not the fault of the All India Radio staff. It is obviously the difference between independent public service broadcasting and government service broadcasting. And incidentally, the reason given for the all the delay was that they were afraid that riots would break out. Well, of course, they didn't do a very good job of stopping the riots, which did break out, so it's all rather futile. But there would be, I think, an impact in this country if you had public service and broadcasting. Now, so I've told you some of the reasons why we give, the excuses we give for not, as I think it, doing our job in this respect. And there are also some more personal reasons which journalists have. It's not glamorous, quite frankly. You're not going to get on the front page very often. People want to be in charge of the political brief or the financial brief or the PMO's office or something like that. And there are not much sort of kudos in being what I might call a Dehati correspondent. But I do have to add that there are excellent Dehati correspondents in the newspaper reporters in all the different parts of India, and like the Hindustan Times correspondent Ejaz, who funny enough came to see me only this morning, who did that story about the tribal who was sold all those motorcycles. So it's not glamorous. That's one problem for us, personally. It requires a lot of effort. We're not sitting around in air-conditioned offices or sitting around drinking tea, waiting for meetings to end and all that sort of thing. You're out in the sun, you're involved in long drives, you're staying in seedy hotels or perhaps not even a hotel at all. So it's hard work. And let's face it, are you interested in? Are you as a journalist, just like so many other people, looking away? So finally, almost my tale of woes, which I want to cheer up a little at the end, what can be done? Well, I think we can have more coverage. And I have an idea that we have columns, and so many of them are, I write one, but I only write one a month because I'm so old and so lazy I can't think of a subject more than once a month. But I do try in that column to say something about the sort of areas that I'm talking about now. But for most people, the columns are all about what has happened that week. And in Delhi, and in and around Delhi, and in and around the metropolises. Why can't we have regular columns which tell actual stories about the way officials behave, about BPL cards not being given, about all the things which happen in rural in India and in the slums, and just tell those stories as they happen. And I think this would have a very shocking impact on people, because people do not realize what is happening in those sort of places. So I think that that is something which we could definitely do. And I think we could also do something which we're always told we're not doing, which is to stay with stories. Take the corruption issue. Let's keep that issue as a broad thing as well, not just each specific Gotala. Let's go on and on about rural banking. Let's follow closely the whole story about electronic banking. Is it working? Is it not working? We heard stories that a lot of people had accounts and had no money in them. Have we followed those up? Let's follow up stories as well. And let's also be absolutely clear that we are not just stenographers. Which was something we were accused of by PCNR. We do not just take the government version as Saeed's friends in Rajasthan did. We don't just take notes of the government version and publish that. So these, I think, are things which can be done. Coming now to you. I think that we are clearly bear a lot of blame. But so does everyone else who is in a privileged position in this country and does not keep themselves aware of what is happening in the areas I have talked about. There are, of course, so many wonderful examples of storytelling about what does happen. There's Peepli Live, for instance. Sean Benigal made that wonderful film about villagers who went to report that their well had been stolen. and it was based on the fact that they had all the papers to say that the approvals had been given, everything well had been dug. So they went to see the Thanadar, and they said to him, Thanadar saab, aap dekh sakte hai, ka hamara paas kuan hai, lekin kuan nahi hai. The Thanadar said, ye kaisa ho sakte hai. And of course, the whole film went on, because the Thanadar had to accept that there was no well, so the well had been saved. And that was produced by, directed by Sean Bedingfield. And Sean is one of the people who has written on the back of Harsh's book, which I said is such a shocking book. And I don't mean shocking in the sense of bad, politically bad, but a book which shocks me and should shock you. And he has said, this deeply moving account points to solutions that are seemingly difficult to achieve, but not impossible, if tackled with a sense of compassion, care, and an active conscience. With a sense of compassion, care, and an active conscience. Those are the words of Charles Bellingham. So the question I would ask is, can we arouse a conscience which will demand a transformative government? Demand a transformative government. And can the media play a significant role in creating the concern, if you like to say, the sense of shame even, that will awaken consciences? Because in the end, if one's really being hard-hitting, much as we all love this country, much as this country has done for all of us, we cannot be happy about those figures which go around the globe about the human, United Nations Human Index. Now, finally, really finally, I'm getting a bit like those parsons in church when they make a very boring sermon, and four times they say, and lastly, and you think, thank God, and it isn't lastly, but this is the lastly. I've talked of balance, and I've talked of how the BBC has taught me about balance. And there is a danger that I'm giving you the impression that there are no members of the elite and middle classes who have a conscience about less fortunate Indians. And of course that is absolute rubbish. Many, many fight against government ineptitude and callous officialdom. One thinks of the very obvious example of Aruna Roy and her colleagues, and how through the right to information they have done so much to get the information which should help to do something about the way that officials behave with poorer people. And there are many, more like that. There are also journalists, peace I know that remember, who do see it as their job to do what I believe they should be doing. But Indians like Sean Benegal, Ashish Nandi, and Urvashi Bhutalia wouldn't have endorsed Harsh's book if they didn't feel there was what I might call a conscience deficit among the elite and the middle classes. As I have lived happily in this country for nearly 50 years, I have to question my own conscience. And as a journalist who has had the presumption and privilege to report and comment on India for all those years, I have to question what I have done to arouse my listeners and readers' awareness of the need for more transformative government. Thank you all very much.
About 20 minutes for questions, and I think Mark has agreed to take questions. Identify yourself, raise your hand, identify yourself, speak, and then be brevity is always extremely good. It's clarity, and even be able to understand and answer better.
Use the mic.
Sir Mark Tully and Saeed Naqvi. My name is Gaurav. I'm a freelance journalist. I really like the point that Mark made that we should come up with regular columns which include those stories of how BPL cards are not being made or given to people who can already afford a lot of things in their life. But my question is, when you come up with such things and approach the editor, the question is, what's the story? What's the new thing is happening? So how do you counter that question, and how do you bring the newness in? Because it's the same thing going on since 60 years. So what's the new thing?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I think that's a very good question. Often talk in journalists of newsworthy. But there is another way of saying that, worthy of news. One argument, of course, is to put the sort of things which I have said to the editor and say, this is worthy of news. You may not think it's newsworthy. And once we start to do it, I think the stories like you would, I'm sure, write the stories brilliantly. And then they are interesting stories. And sometimes they're funny, sometimes they're sad. But they're interesting stories, colorful stories very often. So if one can break through this barrier and say, look, no one else is doing it, okay, great, let us be the first one. It may increase our circulation, actually. And also argue with them that, this is worthy of news. You may not think it's newsworthy, but it is worthy of news. It's not going to be easy. But again, if you get other colleagues who are interested in doing this, I'm sure, of course, as a freelance, you don't belong to a community like you do if you were working with Star Times or something. But certainly people like Ijaz, who wrote that story about the tribal in Jharkhand and the motorbicycles, he would welcome the opportunity to write these stories and to be part of a regular column, rather than have his story just a sort of fourth page, at the bottom of the fourth page of the paper. But you have a problem, but I do think perhaps there are ways of solving it.
Yes.
I think you're being very optimistic about that. I'm Nandini Sahai. I used to be in a press institute in India, and we used to bring out a journal called Grassroots, if you remember. Ajit Parachariji, was the editor of Grassroots, and he also used to bring out Vidura. Mm. And Grassroots was an experiment, where it was a monthly newspaper, where we used to source 50% of our stories from newspapers, and 50% used to be our original. And I tell you one thing, that there, the kind of stories you're talking about, there's a lot of that in the regional press. The regional media carries a lot of human interest stories. But when it comes to so-called national newspapers, that's where commercialism comes in, and money, advertising. Nobody's going to carry the story because they say, who's going to meet? The newspaper runs on advertising. No advertiser is going to pay you for poverty, writing on poverty and rape and murder. I mean, like those kind of hunger stories. We had a problem with Grassroots. Because we wanted our stories, we wanted those stories to be carried in the mainstream media. But once in a blue moon, probably in 6 months, one of our stories would be picked up, and there were very, very good stories. They were sourced from all over the country. So the media, in the so-called national media that we're talking about, I think is totally commercial. And we know what happens. There are newspapers like the Hindu and the Indian Express. Sarnath writes for Hindu. You know what the circulation is of those two newspapers and the advertising. And what the other newspapers with 5 lakh, 10 lakh, 15 lakh circulation, they are not interested, and they're the newspapers which are read. What do you do? How do you tackle this? This has been a...
Well, I suggest in some ways. I mean, I absolutely understand what you're saying. One of the reasons I spoke in this way is because I wanted to point out in a way that this is happening. But there is the point which I made about us journalists standing together and saying we think this is what a newspaper should be doing. And so we will stand up for our right to say that this is what a
what a newspaper should be doing. I don't necessarily believe that all this is going to change tomorrow or anything like that, but I do believe there is a hope, there must be a hope somewhere for a national, for a major paper to try running a column like this. With this very specific direction to it, and with the insistence that you have first-class writers doing the job, or first-class editors who could turn the stories into good stories and that sort of thing. If we despair, we'll get nowhere, will we? That's the other answer. Whereas if we keep on about it and think about it and everything, maybe we will.
Just one more point. We had given a suggestion many years back when Right to Information came in, that at least a newspaper should run a regular column on stories which they have sourced from Right to Information. Mm-hmm. That also, I mean, how many newspapers do we know which regularly use RTI to get, you know, stories like the one you're talking about?
I know, but you're just continuing to talk the tale of the world. I'm saying don't despair, at least, you know, try something else, you know. try again.
You may end a little.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Identify yourself.
Mr. Naqvi and I joined the States when it was almost at the same time, 45 years ago. He became a world famous, very successful journalist. I was a great failure. And therefore, like most failed journalists, I became a small writer.
Identify yourself.
That's what I'm doing. I began, like most Fijian, as a small writer in Fiji. Listening to Mark Tully, in the light of what has happened near House of Commons and the Fleet Street, News of the World and what Murdoch did, and the journalists were complicit in that, including some members of the Parliament. You talked about transformative government. How should the media and the institutions of media transform itself so that the credibility that we have lost, the newspapers are dying every day, readership, as the lady said, is decreasing. What do you think we as journalists and as institutions who believe in that freedom of the press, because is there a freedom of the press now? You have to make that very clear anymore in the multinational huge organizations that are running the newspapers today in support of governments in power. And it seems to me that unless journalists themselves transform into thinking writers that you mentioned, all the names you mentioned, most of them are very thoughtful writers, and the institutions of media, how do they transform themselves before we can claim to transform the governing world?
Well, I'm not sure that you say, how can we transform those institutions, or how can they be transformed?
The media itself.
Does physician heal thyself? That's what he's saying. Yeah. He's saying media has to transform itself. Is there any room for the media transforming itself before it has sufficient credibility to be able to address the issues that you have raised?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. It shows why you've been such a successful journalist.
What I have said is this, that I think there is no hope about doing this unless we stand together and try to restore our authority. One of our troubles as journalists is we're all far too individualistic. If you put three journalists together and said, let's form a trade union, you'd have three separate trade unions in no time at all. I think the only way we can do it is by standing together and, as I said, respecting and demanding respect for our profession. Saying that doctors are professionals, they stand together, lawyers are professionals, they have a bar council. We journalists should stand together, and we should be looking at something which takes journalism beyond just being a means to make money. You probably remember that Lord Rothermere, who founded the Daily Mail, once told the journalist, don't bother about principles or anything like that. The public is only interested in three things: stories about health, stories about wealth, and stories about sex. And quite often when you read the British newspapers, you think that the doctrine of Lord Rothermere is still alive. So I think that is the only answer. You know, things can change, things do change, if people stand together. But I see no chance of it at the moment. You know, well, no evidence. Sorry, I wouldn't say chance. No evidence. Yes.
Just one line to add to Mark in answer to your question. This whole system of proprietorship, ownership of newspapers, in a culture of capitalism where the proprietor is in cahoots with the government, and in a culture of crony capitalism, the media will always be a dispensable. He will be crushed in the middle. He will always be used. He will always be denied his right to the credibility that you demand. So therefore, not always, and there will be skirmishes, there will be guerrilla fighters in the media, and they do it. They find the space in despite it. But by and large, this whole culture that has grown since 1990, much more than ever before, is all pervasive, and this might take, Mark may or may not agree with me, unless this changes, the kind of credible journalism which is independent and which has credibility is going to be rare. Sorry, you there in the white shirt.
Sorry, can I just add one point? Of course, we mustn't forget what I said about public service broadcasting, which if you had it in this country, and if it was well run, would give opportunities for this type of journalism, which we're talking about. And you know, there are alternative forms of ownership to this stock market share type company ownership. For instance, in Britain, one of the most successful retailing groups is the John Lewis Group, which is owned by all the employees. So there could be an opening, for instance, to fund an employees, a joint cooperative type of newspaper. If you're right, of course, and it's pursued the sort of journalism I'm talking about, all the members of the cooperative would be out of pocket very quickly. But it is an alternative which could be tried.
White shirt, Beth. Yes, sir. Identify yourself.
Good evening. I'm Satvir Singh. I'm for the scholarly halls.
I was there at the hospital early in the morning, and Satish was standing right next to me. And at that point of time, I recall that we all knew what had happened. We all knew there was just a handful of people, five or six people, reporters at that time. And by 11 o'clock, we knew. You say the story was out at 9:30. I do not know whether that's correct or not. But none of the people at that time had the confidence to say that Mrs. Gandhi was dead. She died, as you were saying, if the story was out at 9:30, it was quite a story at 9:30, which I do not know. But I do recall, I think at 2 o'clock, the story was out at 2 p.m. Because I was there till 4:35 in the evening. And of course, the rest is, everybody knows what happened in the evening. Now, I have an observation, and Saeed Naqvi has done a lot of programs for us on Doordarshan, the World Report and others. I am a little disturbed at this point of time, where the private channels have come in a large way. The ownership is still what equity is with whom it has to be judged, and reporting has to be done, as you rightly said, you know, crony journalism or whatever. I am disturbed at this point of time that television has taken the heat. Ordinary channels are also calling themselves national. Everybody calls themselves national. There are 1.5 hour long, 1 hour shows, and you have the same handful of people from Delhi or Lutyens Delhi or whatever you might call, who talk on the same things day in and day out. You see them in this channel, half an hour, you see them on that channel. I really wonder that all the intellect think tanks in Bangalore, in Hyderabad, in universities, IIM, IITs, all across the nation, which we at one point of time tried to, you know, register and bring them to the fore, is all let down to a handful of people here. Where is the media going to play a hand in governance? Same handful of people from Pakistan, we know what they're going to say. Same Suhail Seth will talk on Coca-Cola, on Hussein in London, and just about everything, because everybody is a master on anything. But the actual intellectual thought, which should be at the grassroots level, where the transformation should come in smaller cooperatives, as you just mentioned, and the FM also going in groups. This so-and-so owns 10 FM channels here, 20 there. It's all where? Where is the governance going to be led by the media? I'm really worried. I spent 20, 30 years in the electronic media, but I was very happy to see you both talk because you're great journalists. But where are we headed?
Well, I didn't really want to say very much about that, except to say that, yes, I am amazed that the channels go on and on putting out these discussion programs, because you were talking about stories which don't get a readership. I personally cannot understand how anyone wants to watch those discussion programs, especially, as you rightly say, the same stage army parades from studio to studio. I regret to say that I occasionally take part in them, but I'm not a regular member of the stage army, and I sometimes think I shouldn't be one at all. But no, I agree basically. I think there's a real crisis in Indian television.
To add to a line there, yesterday on page one of the Hindu across six columns, you have a story that the government of India is bringing in a bill in which all the victims of persecution in neighboring countries, in Bangladesh and Pakistan, will be accorded citizenship. And the next question was, which are they, is it community sensitive? So yes, Jains, Zoroastrians, Hindus, Christians, and that's it. Now, when I read it in the morning, I said, you know, it's a very fundamental thing that this particular bill is doing. It is now beginning to create a much, much bigger divide. Now, this happened yesterday. Hindu this morning, I must add in parenthesis, did carry a sound editorial, but on that channels that he's talking about, here is a theme, a straightforward theme for a wonderful discussion, but it will never ever take place. It's all four or five or six themes, and then you have these shouting matches, and this which is considered exciting. Yes, the lady there. Sorry, the lady here has voted. Sorry? Yes, please.
I'm Saeed Naqvi, a scholar of history and film at the University of Delhi. My question is, whenever you look at the landscape as a journalist, you have a problem to find an authentic version. So always the news are subjected to the interpretation. What should be the approach of interpreting the news? And second, when there are multiplicity of news versions, what are the ways and what should be the system of finding a finest version? And what are the suggestions from you to the listeners when they listen to the news?
I think that really there is no answer to your question except to say that each individual has to judge for themselves, and you judge by the record. And if, for instance, you find that you have been misled by a channel or by a newspaper, then you become very cautious about reading that or believing that channel. So I think it's a matter for personal judgment, really.
Hello, my name is Radhika Mittal and I'm a media sociologist.
Can
you hear me now? My name is Radhika Mittal and I'm a media sociologist. So I essentially study the sociology of the media. I'm going to make a very controversial sort of statement or suggestion.
It may not be.
But should we perhaps just relieve the fourth estate of its responsibility to the public sphere? Given that we're all talking about the ecosystem here, the problems with the ecosystem, would relieving the fourth estate maybe resolve the issues of corporatization, contentious ownership issues, paid news, and sensationalism as journalism? If we allow an alternative media system to then develop, you know, as Nandini said, maybe grassroots, maybe community radio, wherein at least there is an official connect with people, what they're listening to on these alternative systems is real news, or is news that matters, or has opinions and perceptions that affect them directly and, you know, make an impact to their lives. Second, and this ties in with what you said about balance, because I'm talking about corporatization and ownership, of course. And you said journalists need to stand together. So perhaps with journalists standing together, the real fault here is in our training and education of journalists. What do we now train the new lineage of journalists to develop? How do we understand, how do we make them understand ethics or community building or issues like that? Because I find that that's really not something that's taught at journalism schools at all.
Well, on your second point, if it's not taught, it should be taught. The role of the journalist, the job of the journalist and all that absolutely should be taught. On your first point, I think we should certainly have a policy that, you know, let many flowers bloom, and we should encourage those flowers to bloom as well. And when they're sort of flowers which need rather more tender care, like, for instance, community radio does, then we should try and take special care for them. But I don't think we should do anything. I don't think the point of what I was trying to say really was that we should not forget this conscience deficit in this country, and we should not forget the potential of the big time media, the ones which people read most and are influenced by most, the potential of them for arousing our consciences. That's, I think, what I would say about that.
We have now exactly 2 to 3 minutes, and this two very brief questions. One, the lady there, and the gentleman there. I'm sorry.
Hello, good evening. I'm not a journalist. I'm just a citizen of this country, and I've been hearing the journalists. I want to say something. I watch a lot of...
Your question today.
I'm just coming to the question that as a citizen, I'm watching the news, reading the newspaper, and I'm seeing social media. Everybody's telling whatever is coming on the television is because the public wants it. But as a public, I'm saying we are really discontented with what is being shown. So how do we put across this to the media that we are not happy with what they are showing? So don't put it on us that we want it. That is why they are showing all those drama and jokers sitting there on the TV.
One more question. Yes, who else?
Namaskar, sir. I'm Harsh Narayan. I'm from Speak Media. I have a particular issue with the media right now these days because very little news on art and culture scene is coming in media. I know television media is too commercial, but even in newspaper, nationalized mainstream newspaper, for an example, one of the greatest maestro star, Asad Ali Khan, died. None of the newspaper covered news. Nobody had any idea about his demise. So I'm seeing not as charity. This news should not be carried as a charity, because art and culture is a very strong rooted system in our country, and Khasa belong to Delhi. He was a Delhiite, a British maestro. So media, the major mainstream news media, electronic media is not at all looking at this, but even mainstream newspapers are.
Well, yeah, mainstream newspapers do have magazine sections where they do look, but certainly I would have thought a maestro like that should be mentioned. It should have some form of obituary in the main part of the paper. And it is certainly true that the main parts of the papers don't do much about
it. It is absolutely shameful. It is shameful what you said. In fact, this has always been the case. This Palestinianism in the Indian media, you have never had a great... When we started and when Mark and I got into journalism, there was one man called Charles Fabry, which is a Hungarian gentleman. He was looking after theater, he was looking after music, and he was looking after dance. Then you had one Shimbulu, wonderful man. He knew all about Carnatic music. And during the season in Chennai, he was sponsored by one of the artists. He would fly down at her expense or his expense, live at his expense and her expense, and cover the entire music, that amazing festival of music. And you knew what was, and it would appear in newspapers here. So therefore, it's been disgraceful. The manner in which newspapers have ignored, as someone said, that the three C's which guide them, which is cinema, cricket, and and of course, on a cheerful note, Mark, Australia were all out for 60. Did you know that?
What? Yeah.
For 27 without loss.
Yes,
yes.
All out, Robert. 8 for 15.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you all very much for your questions and for listening to the patient. And thank you very much also for the great honor and privilege of being allowed to give this lecture.